this guy, thank you. And this is his translator, Shida Dayan, and she will have somewhere to sit momentarily, we promise. Grab that. All right. Well, I wonder if we could first start off just talking about the genesis of this film. As I understand it, you were working on an entirely different project when the idea for this film kind of came up and sort of derailed you. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Idea اولیش از سالها پیش با من اومد.
The first idea came to me years ago.
من داشتم فیلم چهارشنبه سوری رو کار میکردم که یه دوستی یه خاطره‌ای برای من تعریف کرد.
I was making my film Fireworks Wednesday when a friend of mine told me a story, a memory.
گفت که قراره یه سفری بره برای اینکه زن همسرش رو که باهاش زندگی کرده بودی مدتی و سالها بود ازش جدا شده بود طلاقشون رو توی اون سفر میرفت که رسمی بکنه به لحاظ حقوقی به سرانجام برسونه.
My friend was going on a trip to make his divorce and his separation official from his wife, whom he had separated from years ago.
این تو ذهن من موند ولی هیچ وقت فکر نمی‌کردم که راجبش یه فیلمی بسازم.
This had stayed with me, but I never thought that I'll make a movie about it.
ولی سالها بعد وقتی داشتم روی فیلمنامه دیگه کار میکردم یک بار اینقدر در واقع ذهن من درگیر کرد و فکر کردم چقدر موقعیت عجیبیه که یک کسی که با یه زنی زندگی کرده دوباره چند روزی رو زیر سر بعد از جدایشون دوباره زندگی کنن.
This had occupied my mind for a long time and I always found it quite strange that when someone lives with some person and then they separate, then they get back together and they start living under the same roof. So years after, this came back to me.
And can you tell us a little bit about sort of how you filled out the idea and wrote the screenplay? I just discovered a few minutes ago that you didn't actually speak French when you wrote the screenplay. So tell us about the writing process there.
من فرانسه موقعی که شروع کردم به نوشتن این فیلمنامه هیچی فرانسه نمی‌دونستم.
When I started writing the script, I didn't know any French.
ولی برای ساختن برای نوشتن این فیلم و ساختن این فیلم رفتم و فرانسه زندگی کردم. دو سال اونجا زندگی کردم.
But in order to write and make this film, I went and I lived in France and I lived there for 2 years.
یکم با زبان فرانسه آشنا شدم. منظورم بیشتر ملودی و آهنگ زبان فرانسه است.
I became familiar with French, but what I mean more is that I became familiar with the music of the language.
من فیلمنامه رو به فارسی نوشتم و یه کسی اون رو ترجمه میکرد به فرانسه و فقط کارش ترجمه نبود. و این وقتی که من مینوشتم مدت‌ها با هم دیگه روی ترجمه کار میکردیم.
I was writing the script in Persian, but someone was helping me with translating it. And was translating the script, but it wasn't just translation. We were working on the French version together.
وقتی که یه چیزی رو یه جمله رو مثلا یه دیالوگی رو ترجمه می‌کرد برای من کاملا توضیح می‌داد که چرا این کلمات رو استفاده کرد چه کلمات دیگه‌ای می‌تونسته استفاده کنه که نکرده و من آگاه بودم که این ترجمه چه اتفاقی درش افتاده.
So when, for instance, one dialogue was being translated, the translator was telling me exactly what the word choices were, what other word choices there were there and weren't being used. And I was completely aware of the language that was being used in the script.
Do you feel like the writing process, therefore, was the act of sort of filling out that original idea, that spark of the idea that you had, was that influenced by that process, do you think?
کاملا من اولش یکم نگران بودم به خاطر زبان فکر می‌کردم که یه مانع بزرگه و ممکنه که اون چیزی رو که من توی ذهنم از فیلم نقش بسته طرف مقابلم چه بازیگر چه گروه متوجه نشن.
I was in the beginning. I was a little worried about the obstacle of language, and I was thinking that maybe what I have in mind may not come out as well or the way I intended to. for the audience or for the actors.
ولی وقتی که فیلم نامه نوشته شد و ترجمه شد و بازیگرها دادن و خوندن یا گروه بعد از خوندنش همون حسی رو داشتن که من داشتم یه حس مشترک پیدا کرده بودیم.
But after the writing was finished and I gave the script to the actors, they had exactly the same feeling as I had. We actually had a communal feeling together.
چیزی که من تجربه کردم اینه که ما درسته که از طریق کلمات و با زبان با هم دیگه ارتباط برقرار میکنیم آدم ها با هم دیگه بیشتر از طریق زبان ارتباط برقرار میکنیم ولی پله اوله بعد دیگه چیزهای دیگه باعث میشه که ما بتونیم خودمون رو با دیگران در واقع در ارتباط بذاریم مثل نگاه کردن مثل یه انرژیه که فارغ از زبان رد و بدل میشه.
Based on my experience, of course, language is one way that we communicate with one another. But this is only the first step. And after this step, there are other things that come in between. For instance, looking or and a certain energy that might get transferred between people.
And tell us a little bit about the casting process, particularly for your lead three actors. How did you first connect, for instance, with Bernice Peugeot?
من اولین کسی رو که برای این فیلم نام انتخاب کردم طاها رحیم بود که فیلم پروفیت رو ازش دیده بودم. خیلی بازیش رو دوست داشتم و فکر کنم که یه روزی باش کار میکنم. و برای یه فیلم نامه که قبل از این نوشته بودم باش صحبت کردم و خیلی سریع دوست شدیم با هم و مرتب همدیگر رو میدیدیم.
The first person I casted for this movie was Taha Rahim. I had seen him in The Prophet and I really liked his acting and I always had him in mind for another script that I had written before this. And then when I met him, we became friends quickly and we started thinking about it.
Bernice رو من با فیلم The Artist شناختمش. همون زمانی که من برای فیلم Separation می اومدم امریکا برای پروموشن، اونم برای The Artist می اومد. توی سفرهایی که به نیویورک، به کالیفرنیا داشتیم و جای مختلف امریکا، مدام همدیگر رو توی هتل می دیدیم و توی مراسم های مختلف آشنا شدیم با هم دیگه.
I met Bernice over her acting in The Artist and when I came to US for the Oscars for the Oscar ceremony for A Separation I would run into her all the time. We were in the same hotel or we would be in the same ceremonies together.
وقتی که دیدمش احساس کردم که یه چیزی که برای من مهمه برای انتخاب بازیگر اینه که بازیگر فرقی نمیکنه چه نقشی بازی کنه بتونه یه انرژی مثبتی به من بده بتونه یه احساس سمپاتی نسبت بهش ایجاد پیدا کنم. اون بازی برنیس این رو داشت تو خودش. وقتی باش برخورد میکردم یه سمپاتی همه باش داشتن و خود من همینجور.
Something that is important for me in casting is that the actor is able to transfer to me a positive energy and can create in me a sympathetic feeling. And that was true about Bernice.
Is it possible to change this light? It looks like it's very heavy.
It's a tough light, isn't it? You can't really see anyone, can you? Yeah. He's a director.
Yeah, I can't see this.
We'll see if I can do something about that. But I wonder if also we could talk a little bit about some of the choices you made in how you told the story visually in framing some of your shots. I'm sure a lot of people here tonight noticed a lot of windows and invisible barriers and reflections and obstructions. What was your thinking?
توی تصویر اتفاقایی که میفته توی ساختن حرف این به دو تا چیز ربط داره. یکی به همون قصه ای که من دارم میسازمش و یکی به اون ناخودآگاهی که در همه فیلم ها مشترکه و اون ناخودآگاه منه.
What happens in any filmmaking of my films has to do with two elements. One is the storyline, the plot. The other one is my unconscious. When I look back at my own films, I see that there are repeating elements in them. And that is, for instance, windows or window panes, or the fact that you cannot really see the characters very directly. There is always an obstacle between the character and the camera.
احساس کنم در ناخودآگاه این اتفاق افتاده در ناخودآگاه من این علاقه بوده که این شکلی کاراکتر رو ببینم و بعد آگاه شدم بهش و توی فیلم جدایی و توی فیلم گذشته این رو آگاهانه استفاده کردم.
I realized that unconsciously this is what I wanted to do and then I became aware of it and I started using it consciously in Separation and also in the past.
مثل شروع فیلم گذشته که دو تا آدمی در واقع دو طرف شیشه هستن، یه موقعیت خیلی روزمره است توی فرودگاه، حرف میزنن ولی همدیگر رو نمیشنون. یه جوری احساس میکردم که این آدم ها تا انتهای فیلم همین جوریه که با هم حرف میزنن ولی همدیگر رو نمیفهمن. انگار که بقیه فیلم هم یه شیشه بین اینا هست ولی ما اون شیشه رو نمیبینیم.
For instance, the opening scene of the past, there are two people who are being separated from each other with a window and they're talking to each other but they're not hearing each other. And throughout the film, this is true about these two people. They're talking, but they can't communicate. There's always something in between them.
It seems also notable that whereas in a film like A Separation, you use a lot of handheld cameras, whereas in this film, the camera's very still. Is that, can you tell us about that choice?
توی فیلم جدایی دوربین همش روی دوش بود به خاطر اینکه من برام مهم بود که یه ریتم زندگی اون شهر رو و استرسی که توی اون موقعیت اون آدم ها وجود داشت رو از طریق تصویر به تو منتقل کنم.
In A Separation, the camera was always handheld because it was important to me to show the rhythm of stress in a city that was in which that story was happening, and it was important for me to show that stress.
توی فیلم جدایی اتفاق در همون لحظه و زمان حال رخ میداد و مقابل دوربین، ولی در فیلم گذشته اتفاقا همون پیش از این رخ دادن و فقط تبعاتشون رو داریم میبینیم و این یه جوری به من میگفت که دوربین باید دوربین آرام تری باشه.
In A Separation, everything that was happening in front of the camera and it was happening in the present time. So the camera had to show that. But in the past, everything that was happening had happened already in the past. So something was telling me that the camera had to be more still, it had to be more calm, and what we were seeing were only the consequences of the past.
اگه بخوایم خوب متوجه بشیم، دو تا صحنه است توی این دو تا فیلم که شبیه هم هست. دو صحنه مشترک، صحنه دادگاه جدا شدن یک زن و شوهر که توی فیلم جدایی اول فیلمه و دوربین روی دوشه و اون استرسی که توی فضا هست رو احساس میکنیم و توی فیلم گذشته دوربین روی دوش نیست و آرام تره.
I'll give an example of the two films. When we look in A Separation, there is a scene that is common with the past. In A Separation, there is a scene that the husband and wife are sitting in the courtroom and it's the scene of their divorce. And it's very much stressed and the camera is handheld and it's showing the stress and everything that is being decided at the moment. But when we look in the past, the camera is still because it's already been decided and they've already made peace with it.
توی اون صحنه دادگاهی که زن و شوهر توی گذشته دارن جدا میشن، همه چیز قبلا اتفاق افتاده 4 سال پیش، اونا جدا شدن، فقط الان اومدن که امضا کنن و تموم بشه.
In that court scene in the past, everything has already happened. Everything is already set. They're only there to sign papers and get done with it.
You also were a visitor in a city that is one of the most cinematic cities the world has, and yet you showed us a very kind of quotidian, day-to-day, unglamorous side of that city. Was that also a conscious choice?
توی یه خطری که فیلمسازی توی شهرهای شناخته شده دنیا مثل پاریس، روم وجود داره اینه که همون تصویر رو که کلیشه رو که مردم از طریق سینما از اون شهرها کشف کردن دوباره به اونها ارائه بدیم.
There is a danger in making movies in cities like Paris or Rome that have been known in the cinema. And that danger is showing the people exactly what they see, showing them all the clichés back into the cinema.
برای اینکه این فیلم از این نظر توریستی نشه، سریع تصمیم گرفتم که از اون جذابیت های اولیه شهر رد بشم و برم روی لایه دیگه از شهر.
In order to avoid this danger, I decided right away that I'm going to go beyond these initial attractions of these scenes and of these cities.
بخاطر همین سعی رفتم بیرون از توی حومه پاریس خونه شخص دست رو انتخاب کردم.
Therefore, I quickly moved to the suburbs of Paris and I chose the location.
Another thing that's very interesting, I think, about the way you work is you have quite a long rehearsal process for a film. I wonder if you could tell us a little bit about it, like how long and where did you do it? Did you do it on location or in a studio? Tell us about that.
No, توی سالونی تمرین میکنیم ما و حدود دو ماه سه ماه قبل از فیلم برداری تمرین میکنیم.
We rehearse in a hall and we practice for about 2 or 3 months before shooting.
اگر شما در اون سالن رو باز کنید و بیاین تو، احساس کنید که ما داریم تمرین میکنیم برای اجرای یک تئاتر.
If you look at our rehearsals, it feels like we're rehearsing for a play.
And you have a theater back. Excuse me, you have a theater background, correct? You have a degree in theater. Yeah.
من از در واقع کارم ابتدا با تئاتر شروع کردم. سالها توی تئاتر کار میکردم. سالها نه، 7-8 سال توی تئاتر کار کردم.
In fact, I started my career in theater, and I worked in theater for about 7 or 8 years.
وقتی که داریم تمرین میکنیم ما اینکه میگم شبیه تئاتر کار میکنیم، نه اینکه صحنه‌ای که قراره که فیلم برداری بشه رو مثل تئاتر بیایم اجرا کنیم. ما هیچ کدوم از کمتر صحنه‌های فیلم رو کار میکنیم، بیشتر برای شخصیت‌های بک استوری میسازیم توی تمرین‌ها.
When I say that we rehearse, I don't mean that we rehearse the scenes that we're going to play in the film. I mean that we start making stories, backstories for the characters. We start playing and rehearsing their past, seldom the scenes that we're going to have in the movie.
And can you characterize the way that ends up manifesting on screen, how you end up seeing it on screen and what's actually in the movie?
کاری که میکنیم تو ظاهر بازی ها دیده نمیشه.
What we do is not going to show on the surface of the acting.
براتون مثال میزنم. من توی اون تمرینات دلم میخواست که به نقطه برسیم که رابطه سمیر و ماری رابطه گرم و عاشقانه ای نباشه و رابطه احمد و ماری اگرچه از هم جدا شدن رابطه گرمی از آب در بیاد. این تو تمرین ها شکل گرفت و توی شما بوم میبرید توی فیلم وقتی رو میبینید.
In the rehearsals, what I wanted to do was to create a relationship between Samir and Mary that is not a warm relationship, and instead create a very warm relationship between Ahmad and Mary, who had in fact separated from one another. So you can only see or feel the way the relationship was built when you watch the film.
من توی اون تمرین‌های چند ماهه خیلی کم اتفاق می‌افتاد که تاهار و برنیس رو بذارم با هم دیگه تمرین کنن. همیشه اینو جدا بودن از هم و بیشتر برنیس با احمد تمرین می‌کرد.
In those 2 or 3 months of rehearsals, I didn't really allow Tahar and Berenice to rehearse together. But on the other hand, I led Ahmad and Berenice to be together and practice.
در واقع توی این تمرین رو من سعی میکنم که فاصله کاراکترها با هم دیگر رو یه جوری تنظیم کنم. بعضی از هم دور بشن، بعضی با هم نزدیک بشن.
In these rehearsals, I try to manage the distance between the characters. I make some of the characters get close to each other. I make some of them get distanced.
You also, in more than one film, have worked with younger actors and sometimes child actors. Like in both this film and A Separation, for instance, a younger actor plays a very pivotal role. Is that a conscious choice on your part?
من همیشه وقتی بچه ها سر صحنن انقدر کار باشون سخته که فکر کنم این آخرین باری که باشون کار میکنم، ولی وقتی فیلم تموم میشه اینقدر لذت بخش برام دوباره میام سراغشون.
Usually when I work with children and I'm there at the shooting, it's so difficult to work with them that I always say this is the last time I'm going to have. But afterwards, it's so rewarding that I always go back to them.
بچه ها وقتی میان توی فیلم تو داستان دو تا چیز با خودشون میارن. یکی فضای احساسی عاطفی فیلم رو بیشتر میکنم، مثلا فیلمایی که مثل این فیلم گذشته یا فیلم جدایی، فیلمایی یکم در واقع سنگینی هستن.
Children bring two things with themselves. One is that they add to the emotional way of films. They make it a little lighter. For instance, films like this or like A Separation that already have a gloomy.
دومین چیزی که میارن و خیلی مهمه صداقت با خودشون میارن. و بچه‌ها توی این فیلم ها هستن که بزرگتر به نظر میاد که گاهی حقیقت رو پنهان میکنن.
And the second thing they bring with themselves is honesty. And it is thanks to children that sometimes we can realize that the adults are hiding the truth.
And then you shot this film for about 15 weeks, as I understand it. And does the, through the process of the shooting or maybe in the editing room, do you feel like the film changes much from the screenplay then?
نه، توی همه فیلمان تقریبا اون چیزی که فیلمی که حاصل شده به فیلمنامه‌ای که نوشتم خیلی نزدیک بوده.
No, in all of my films, usually what I end up writing is very close to what I show as a film.
به خاطر که این نوع داستان ها یه جوری مثل پازل همه چیز به هم گره خورده و نمیشه جا به جا کرد چیزی رو.
Because these types of stories are like a puzzle. Everything is interconnected, so you can't really take things and separate them.
And do you know what film you're going to work on next? Will you go back to the film you were working on when you started to work on the past?
دارم فکر می‌کنم به چند تا داستان که فکر می‌کنم اوایل سال آینده یکیشون انتخاب کنم و کار کنم. این چند تا داستان بعضیش توی ایران اتفاق می‌افته، بعضیش بیرون، ولی هنوز تصمیم نگرفتم کدوم رو انتخاب کنم.
I'm thinking about a few plots. Some of them happen in Iran, some of them happen outside, but I'm still thinking about it. I haven't decided yet.
All right, well, we've got time for a handful of questions from the audience. I will try and see you as best I can. But we've got one right here, ma'am.
The question of the film is so intimate, and plays are very much about the plot, the words that are, and how they're spoken. In this film, as in all the films of yours I've seen, what takes me, grabs me, is what is not said, but what I feel between the characters, and yet the words are important. So how do you balance the script and what we see?
I'm going to repeat the question, actually, just so everyone can hear it. The question was about the intimacy of the films and the balance between what is said and what is not said, and the importance of what is not said and how it fits into what is said. And so the question is about how he balances those two things.
توی این فیلم ها چیزی که ما رو بیشتر درگیر میکنه اینه که به نظر میاد آدم ها یه چیزی درونشون هست که راحت نمیتونن بگن و اگرچه زیاد حرف میزنن ولی اون چیزی رو که میخوان بگن هی دارن پنهان میکنن.
What makes us connect in such movies is that the characters cannot easily speak, or if they do, there's always something in the back that they're still holding and they're not saying.
این کار رو هارولد پینتر خیلی خوب انجام میده. آدمای نمایشنامه‌هاش خیلی زیاد حرف میزنن به خاطر اینکه اون چیزی رو که به سه راز نگه داشتن مبادا برملا بشه.
Harold Pinter does this very well. In his plays, the characters talk a lot, exactly because they're trying to hold a secret within and they're afraid of it being shown.
توی این فیلم احمد و ماری خیلی با هم دیگه حرف میزنن راجع به گذشتهشون، ولی همه این چیزها رو میگن که اون رابطه عاشقانه که هنوز تهمانده‌هاش بینشون مونده برملا نشه و وانمود کنن که هیچ چیزی بینشون نیست.
In this film, Ahmad and Mari talk a lot. They say a lot to each other, but they do this exactly to avoid revealing that love relationship that they still are holding on to.
این شاید از فرهنگ من میاد. ما فرهنگمون و زبانمون زبانیه که مستقیم‌گو نیستیم. ما در واقع یه جوری غیر مستقیم همه چیز رو به طرف مقابلمون می‌فهمونیم.
This might be coming from the culture that I have. In our culture and in our language, we don't speak very directly. we go around and circumvent until we tell finally what we want to say, but we don't say it in direct words.
Yes, up front.
In theater, one of the major tools in rehearsal can be improvisation. In this country, directors don't get to rehearse, so they don't usually get to improvise. I'm wondering if improvisation has played a role in developing the characters and some of the plot points. I'm especially thinking of the children, who can be difficult, as we know, to prepare.
Yeah, the question is about improvisation and how much improvisation plays a role in the creation of the character and some of the plot points, particularly in working with some of the children and their moments.
یه چیز در واقع دوگانه‌ای وجود داره اینجا. اگر فیلم رو ببینید و بعد فیلمنامه رو بخونید احساس کنید که هیچ چیزی بداهه نبوده و همون فیلمنامه اجرا شده.
There is a dual factor here. If you first see the film and then read the script, you think that nothing has been added and it's been exactly what's been planned.
ولی اگر همین رو از بازیگر رو بپرسین همشون به شما جواب خواهند داد که خیلی بداهه توی کار وجود داره.
But if you ask this question from the actors, they will all respond to you that there's a lot of improvisation in the work.
به خاطر اینکه وقتی من توی این تمرین چند ماه قبل از فیلم برداری باشون کار میکنم فیلمنامه رو میذارم کنار و آروم آروم یه جوری اونا رو به سمتی میبرم که همون چیزایی که تو فیلمنامه هست اجرا کنن ولی احساس کنن که بداهه دارن خودشون خلق میکنن اون رو.
The reason is that when I rehearse with them two or three months before the shooting, I try to put aside the script. And what I try to do is to add things that's not on the script and put them in the direction that they think they're improvising.
بچه ها کاملا در واقع اون چیزایی که تو فیلم نامه است دارن انجام میدن ولی اصلا بهشون گفته نمیشه که اینن باید فیلم نامه رو بگیم چون اون واکنش منفی نشون میدن همیشه.
Kids are doing what's on the script, but we never tell them that they have to do exactly what's there because they always have a negative reaction to
it. All right, I can't see much out there, but if someone wants to flash their phone or something. I'm sorry, is there? I see a phone over there. Go ahead.
So, I'm just curious, you obviously went to a great deal of effort to shoot this in France, the language that's not your own.
The question is first about, there are two questions. The first is about to why he went to the effort to sort of shoot this film in a city that was not his own with actor, in a language that is not his own with some French actors, and why that was important and what ends up being sort of quite a universal story. And then as a corollary, are there constraints to filming in Tehran? Was there anything, am I getting this right? Was there anything he could do shooting in Paris that he couldn't do in Tehran? Is that kind of, yeah.
من نبودم که تصمیم گرفتم فیلم رو در پاریس بسازم. داستانی که به سراغ من اومده بود و من رو رها نمی‌کرد داستان مردی بود که باید به یه جای دوری سفر می‌کرد و اون مرد بعد از کشور من میره به یه کشور دیگری.
This was in me who had decided to make a film in Paris. The story that had come to me was the story of a man who had to travel somewhere far to do what he had to do.
چند دلیل داشت که من فرانسه رو و پاریس رو انتخاب کردم. یکی این که پاریس جاییه که وقتی من میرم توش به نسبت جای دیگه دنیا کمتر احساس غریبگی میکنم.
There were a few reasons why I chose France and Paris. One being that Paris is a city that I feel less estranged from when I'm there.
به خاطر اینکه مردم فرانسه بعد از مردم ایران بیشترین تماشاگر فیلم‌های من بودند.
And the reason is that after the Iranian people, the French are the biggest audience that I have.
نکته دوم این که وقتی شما یه فیلم میخواییم بسازیم که موضوعش گذشته است و راجع به گذشته است، بهتره که شهری رو انتخاب کنیم که گذشته توش وجود داشته باشه، زنده باشه و تاریخ همیز که اون شهر حضور داشته باشه.
Second point is that when you're making a film about the past, it's best to choose a city in which there is the past and you can feel it and it's live and there's history.
من این فیلم رو توی تهران هم میتونستم بسازم، ولی یکم تفاوت میکرد با چیزی که توی پاریس ساختم، جزئیاتش فرق میکرد.
Of course I could have made this film in Tehran as well, but it would have been different. The details would have been different.
و چون توی این نوع فیلم هایی که من کار میکنم جزئیات اهمیت زیادی داره، وقتی که جزئیات عوض بشه شما شاید یه فیلم دیگری خواهید بود، یعنی اصلا فیلم کل فیلم عوض میشد.
And because the type of films I work on are very important in details, if the details change, then the whole film changes, and you would have been seeing something else.
I think we've got time for one more. Go ahead, right here in the front.
Hi, how are you? I'm curious about the writing process, because the film is so detailed, and it's like, how do you come up with all these? And I'm also curious about how early do you give the script to your actors?
The question is about the writing process and how early he gives the scripts to the actors in the rehearsal process.
اگه صادقانه بخوام بگم واقعا نمیدونم چیکار میکنم. من موقعی که کار میکنم خودم رو نمیدونم از بیرون، ولی میتونم یه حدسایی بزنم.
Honestly, I don't know what I do when I'm working. I can't see myself from afar, but I can have some guess.
کاری که میکنم اینه که خیلی سعی میکنم زمان بذارم برای نوشتن و منظم بنویسم، یعنی به سرعت نمینویسم.
What I do is that I dedicate a lot of time to writing, and I write in a very timely and orderly fashion.
برای اینکه توی داستان تویست ایجاد کنم و مسیر قصه عوض بشه، از اتفاقات مهیب استفاده نمی‌کنم. سعی می‌کنم از چیزهای روزمره و بی‌ارزش اون چرخش‌های داستانی رو ایجاد کنم و استفاده کنم.
In order to make twists in the story, I don't bring in very dramatic or very big incidents, but I try to use ordinary day-to-day details that could change.
در یک کلام بهترین الگویی که همه ما داریم برای این کار خود زندگیه، یعنی زندگی ما هم با همین جزئیات بی‌ارزش مدام مسیرش عوض میشه.
Shortly, the best model that we have for this is life itself. If you look at our own lives, it always changes with very minute details.
من توی سال دوم، من توی فیلم گذشته فیلمنامه رو همون اول به بازیگرای اصلی دادم بخونن، چون زبان فرانسه بود، زبان اونا فرانسه بود، زبان من فارسی بود و نیاز داشتم که اونا بدونن فیلمنامه چیه.
And about the second question, for the past, I gave the script to the actors right away because there was the difference between the languages and we needed time.
ولی ازشون میخواستم که اونو بذارن کنار وقتی سر تمرین بیان و من فقط همون که یه بار خونده بودن کافی بود، دیگه روی اون تمرکز نکنم.
But I asked them to put the script away when they come to rehearsal and just reading it once was enough. I didn't want them to concentrate on that.
توی فیلم درباره‌ای من بهشون ندادم و اونا وانمود میکردن که فیلم رو نخوندن. بعد آخر بار متوجه شدم که یواشکی همشون فیلم رو پیدا کردن خوندن و به احترام من میگن که نخوندید.
When I was making about Ellie, I had asked them not to read the script, and I didn't give them the script, and they were pretending that they hadn't read the script. Later on, I found out that they had all found the script, and they, and they just said they didn't, to respect me.
And that's unfortunately all I have time for. Thank you for being here.